The SVTV Filmmaker Interview Series is brought to you by Roche Winery and Tasting Room at 122 West Bain Street in Sonoma.
I'm Rick Love for the 2014 Sonoma International Film Festival Filmmaker Interview Series here on SVTV 27. And I have with me writer-director Zoran Lisinac and lead actor Iman Crosson from the film Along the Roadside. Had a very packed screening last night at Berlin Game Hall in Sonoma. Welcome to the festival. So, a road movie. And that's what you have. You have a road movie. It starts in the Bay Area. It goes down to Los Angeles. What is it about the road movie and that type of film? And were there specific road movies in mind when you wrote this film?
First of all, thank you for having us. Mm-hmm. And thank you for the lovely welcome.
Certainly.
Road film. I'm a big fan of road, I don't want to say films, but road stories. I feel the structure is as ancient as it gets. You can trace it back to Homer's Iliad, or Odyssey. Mm-hmm. Odyssey, which in fact is a road trip, if you want. And I feel there's something about stories that start from point A, going to point B. In our case of the film, I'm not gonna reveal further than that. Mm-hmm. But there's something about the journey that is just, I have the predilection towards a road trip stories. And as an immigrant, you can say one, I've made a trip from Serbia, Eastern Europe, coming here to discover many different faces, races, voices, accents, and became fascinated with the world I discovered here and wanted to somehow fuse all that into a story about two people who meet themselves at certain points in their life on that trip, and they meet a bunch of other different weird characters who will intersect with their lives and kind of, you know, give each other a piece of themselves along the way.
One of the things that I really liked about the film is the dynamic between you, Iman, and your lead actress, mm-hmm. who is, she was born in Berlin, Germany, but she lives in Austria, and she's colorblind, and there's never any overt reference to her being white Bavarian and you being African American. She only sees blue, and in addition to the national and the language and the differences there, and your character, one of the things I liked about your character is he's prickly, and he stays prickly all the way through. He's kind of an angry guy. So why don't you talk a little bit about that, faced with this almost a puppy dog of a person in your co-lead actress.
Personally, I've never really thought of him so much angry as just very face value, unfiltered. And, you know, he's the kind of guy that, likens himself to a sailor who's, you know, left one shore, hasn't quite reached the other one yet. So he's just kind of going with things the way he sees fit. He doesn't make a lot of apologies. Now, coming across the other actress, Nina, her character Nina, it's to the point where he's so matter of fact about everything, but she, in a certain way, without really trying, finds a soft spot in him in a way. Mm-hmm. You know, and that I thought was a cool dynamic where it's not so blatant that she's trying to crack through to him. She's just being herself, he's just being himself. Mm-hmm. And then somehow they find a meeting point in each other that really makes that spark happen. So
I was actually relieved that there wasn't some huge, you know, he melted and anything like that, because it wouldn't have rang true. I mean, there's a very important scene earlier on in the film where your character is, I think women looking at it would say he's very cold to a previous girlfriend. And, I thought it was cold too.
Mild way
but
to
it's
put
setting,
it.
But it's setting him up as you're kind of setting him up to not like this guy. No, was that what you were thinking of when you were writing that scene?
I'm attracted to anti-heroes as characters that fit in certain stories. Now, an anti-hero in a story that one could categorize as a romantic story is not that often of a character as you can find in an action film or gangster film. But I do like to dare and bash into the walls a bit. By introducing a very unlikable character and see if we could unlock a bit of his humanity along that trip and see further into his character. Mm-hmm. You know,
Well, I think he does show elements of. There's a biker gang going by in the street in front of us here.
It's my cousin.
I think he does show kind of these incremental movements of warmth. And like I said, I was glad that there wasn't some kind of, it would have been false if he'd been a different person at the end of the movie. So I wanted to talk a little bit about, there's a fictional band, Blonde Priest, that play a big role in this movie. Okay. So the music, all original music.
That's correct.
In the movie.
I wish we've persuaded the guy, Cole Bonner, from Sonoma, by the mm-hmm. way, local kid, who wrote all those songs that I've, back to Homer's Odyssey, used or tried to use as a Greek chorus that sort of go along with the story, explaining the story and addressing both characters and the audience alike. I wish we persuaded Cole to keep the name Blonde Priest off the movie, because so many people have so far said, you know, I looked up that band because I liked the music and mm-hmm. I can't find anything right. about it, you know, and we never, this will be a bit spoiler, show the band mm-hmm. in the film, we only hear the music. So, it becomes, what is this thing that this little person traveled across the ocean with all the plane delays and to have that perfect moment that, as she says, I played it out in my head so many times, and she wants to experience that moment the way she wants to experience it, in this case, particularly being in a concert of that particular band, mm-hmm. but having that moment taken away from you, because that's life, that's what happens. And in that sense, on Varney's character, who has this idea of how his life should go and then just not going that way, or something just comes and says you have to just make a turn or stop or break through this wall. So it's one of those, do you take life on its terms, and or do you try to latch onto your dream, do you try to make a bridge between the two, or is that even possible? One of those things. I'm sorry, you asked me about music. I ended up talking about
That's fine. The Greek chorus makes actually, when you put it in the context of the Odyssey, the Greek chorus makes sense. And I like that she plays the music for Varney, and he doesn't say anything. So we don't even know what he thinks about it, because we're expecting. I'm expecting some kind of a snide answer.
That's what we're talking about.
We talked about this last night.
But he doesn't say anything, and I was glad.
Thank you.
Yeah. I was glad that he didn't say.
We're just talking about that. Thank you. We're just talking about that, and it was that I have to credit editor, although he was in the script, but he found the perfect shot.
I was asking him last night, I said, you know, there's one in that very scene, there's one clip of me that bothers me because of my expression. And it's like, it's almost like a non-characteristically Varney face. It's mm-hmm. a face that doesn't look like Varney to me. And I told him that, and I found out just last night that they, him with the editor, put that there on purpose, because it's a moment of, you think he's going to say something snide, and the look on my face is like, I'm about to say something snide, but I don't.
Destroy.
So they edited it that way intentionally to make it look as if I was about to say something, but then I just let it go.
You know, it's interesting, because she says, he says lots of hard things to her,
right.
But the hardest thing would have been to reject this music that she loved so much, and that's why I was glad. It actually made me feel warmer towards him that he didn't. That
yeah,
he didn't reject
it was
her
a
music.
Thank you. Mm. That was my big thing on selling anything when it comes to story, character, emotion. I'm very shy about it. I understand that salesmanship, it's an art form of its own, and people who craft it well become, you know, Steve Jobs. Mm-hmm. Now, I have a bit of an aversion towards hard selling people. You know, I've seen Glenn Ross. I know they're sharks. Mm-hmm. I hate to sell. I like to, as Varney at one point in the film says, I like to show what it is and let the other person meet halfway if they want to. I don't like to manipulate anyone into a story, into a feeling. I really hope to be true to the batter and invite people in a very blunt way to either want to go further with the story of the characters or just stay there and never let the story spill over mm-hmm. off the screen. In that sense, that was tricky with Varney in the story in general, because those subtle notes, the twist, the change, those points that you say, I try not to sell them hard.
Right.
And very subtle, and you're, to be frank, the first person who mentioned that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a particular moment, and we talked about it last night, and so it's good for me to hear that.
Well, and I think too the ending of the film, I felt that it was a kind of redemptive ending because they've been meeting all of these people along the way. I don't want to talk about one of those people in a moment, but everything has a residue. There's a little residual impact that all of these people have on the way, and I felt at the end the music, it comes back to the music, and that resonated with me. That made sense. It worked for me. And even though they're not going to go off into the sunset together, it worked. So one of the people they met, Michael Madsen, Reservoir Dogs, Kill Bill, Donnie Brasco. How did you get Michael Madsen to come and be one of these characters that you meet along the way in your film?
Michael?
The 6'9" brother.
One of the advantages of making this our first film, and with that, you can imagine very, 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 very low budget. If you want to afford or even dare to think about having a star of his caliber into the story, you have to think of days. And one of the things that Road Trip allows is those episodic appearances of actors. Mm-hmm. Because simply as the structure of the story, they come in, they come out. It's been like that for ages. It's one of the beauties of Road Trip stories. And that kind of made it possible. I don't think otherwise it would have been, more than... We had him for one day, mm-hmm. And we shot 9 pages that day. And it was all...
Wow.
Yeah.
So, that's a long day.
I know. So it was... and it was late in the shoot, too. Adrenaline was already down, most of the crew. But we pulled together.
He comes on in that white suit, though. I bet it pumped everybody up a little bit.
Michael is one of those guys, for some reason in my head, he's a bit of a John Wayne kind of an actor.
Absolutely.
He has a persona. He doesn't have to act much, and that's a good thing. And in his case, he really, it's the less he does, more people are trying to read into it, mm-hmm. And I think he uses that trick really well. I think we even posted that on Facebook. De Niro was talking about that. Have to do anything.
Yeah.
Give him as less as you possibly can.
Well, and his voice too carries it.
I know.
Absolutely. The film is Along the Roadside. Writer-director Zoran Lisinac and lead actor Iman Crosson. Thanks very much for coming in speaking with us today.
Thank you.
I'm Rick Love for the 2014 Sonoma International Film Festival Filmmaker Interview Series here on SVTV 27.